Hey guys, so I'm continuing to kind of pull out quotes that really struck me as I read through this book, 12 Years a Slave, by Solomon Northup, where we have just kind of finished kind of pulling quotes from chapter one, and these we're gonna now it's after that, so I think we're gonna start to get to know about like what happened with him, like how did he get into slavery from this free man. Anyway, this is the next quote. The next morning, they suggested that inasmuch as we were about entering a slave state, it would be well, before leaving New York, to procure free papers. The idea struck me as a prudent one, though I think it would scarcely have occurred to me had they not proposed it. So he goes, because he plays the violin, he goes with these group of men to Washington, I think, or they are on their way to Washington, but they visit a slave state on the way. So this is kind of the beginning point of what happens. And I don't really want to get too much into plot details. You know, if you are interested in that, please read this book and get more sense of it. This is really just my responses to some of the things that this book said that's just like, whoa, you know. But this is kind of where the story is going. Next quote. With the evidence of freedom in my possession, the next day after our arrival in New York, we crossed the ferry to Jersey City and took the road to Philadelphia. I think it's kind of interesting that, you know, slavery for him is so out of his mind, so not his reality, that taking the free papers, you know, the evidence that he's free, it wasn't his idea to begin with. It was suggested to him by white people taking him, you know, accompanying him to play some violin together and play music together. But he goes all over the place. He goes to New York, Philadelphia. Anyway, next quote. I gave them my confidence without reserve and would freely have trusted them to almost any extent. Their constant conversation and manner towards me, their foresight in suggesting the idea of free papers, and 100 other little acts unnecessary to be repeated, all indicated that they were friends indeed, sincerely solicitous for my welfare. I know not, but they were. I know not, but they were innocent of the great wickedness of which I now believe them guilty. So foreboding there. There must have been some misapprehension, some unfortunate mistake. It could not be that a free citizen of New York who had wronged no man nor violated any law should be dealt with thus inhumanely. The more I contemplated my situation, however, the more I became confirmed in my suspicions. It was a desolate thought indeed. I felt there was no trust or mercy in unfeeling man, and commending myself to the God of the oppressed, bowed my head upon my fettered hands and wept most bitterly. So that kind of skips over, a lot of what happens for him to get to be in this state, I know. I didn't highlight pretty much any of those parts. I don't know, I thought that was like just a lot of the plot details, but what ended up happening, of course, it's kind of, you can anticipate, you know, he goes to accompanies them to play music, they play music, these people are actually not terribly bad, the people that he went with. But as Solomon Northup says, maybe they were accomplices, maybe they were not. But in the hotel room one time, he has a really dry throat. He needs to get water. And on the way to the water, he gets bonked in the head. Next time he wakes up, he's in chains and nowhere. It's in total darkness as he's just in chains. And that's how he's treated there from the beginning. And that's how he ends up a slave. Like, the details of how he ends up a slave, I don't think is as important as his experience of life before slavery and life after slavery, you know, life during slavery, sorry, and then life after slavery. That's kind of what I'm reading about now. I didn't finish this book, but I'll probably get there. But yeah, next quote. Here we go. The voices of patriotic representatives boasting of freedom and equality and the rattling of the poor slave's chains almost commingled. A slave pen within the very shadow of the Capitol. So there's a slave pen a slave auction house in Washington, D.C. And he just finds it ironic, which it is, that there are all these people kind of being like, chanting out, freedom, we must be patriotic and liberty and all that, and at the same time, they're selling slaves. What ironic thing is that? During this time, Radburn was standing silently by. His business was to oversee this human, or rather, inhuman stable, receiving slaves, feeding and whipping them at the rate of 2 shillings a head per day. So there's kind of an overseer that, you know, is in the slave kind of thing. His only job is to really just look after them, feed them, and whip them if necessary to keep them in line while they're in the transition period. So Solomon Northup is still like a slave in the transition period, meaning he hasn't been sold to any white would-be slave master yet. He's just been kind of being moved around, and I don't know if I highlighted that quote or that part of the book, but no one believes he's free. The more times he says, but I'm a free man, I'm not supposed to be a slave, he's beaten. He's like severely beaten and whipped and pretty much tortured just for saying that he's a free man, you know? So that's kind of the situation that Solomon Northup is in now. Next quote. Okay, so this is kind of one of the many descriptions you'll find of the beatings of Solomon Northup. With the paddle, Birch commenced beating me. Blow after blow was inflicted upon my naked body. When his unrelenting arm grew tired, he stopped and asked if I still insisted I was a free man. I did insist upon it, and then the blows were renewed, faster and more energetically, if possible, than before. When again tired, he would repeat the same question, and receiving the same answer, continue his cruel labor. This is kind of a testament to Solomon Northup's character. To him, he's being honest. I am not a slave. I'm a free man. He is. He was born a free man. He's been one for over 30 years. And he has his own property, he has wife, he has kids. He's being beaten to death. You know, he's being pummeled. And the slave master's like, tired. It's like, so, are you a free man now? Solomon Northup's like, yes, I am a free man. The beating continues even harder. And he's like, are you a free man now? Yes, I am a free man. And then he gets beaten so much. It's ridiculous. Like, he doesn't give up the fact, or at least for a long time, for a period of time, that he's not a slave. He fights that so hard because it's beyond his comprehension. But even more that he fights back. He has a personality of fighting back, and I think you could notice that in the later parts of the book. And so that's, I think, what makes his story so powerful, is this is a man who didn't just give in and accept it, but it's a man who fought it as much as he can, any chance he had with his talents. Ah, crap, my phone is really slow right now, sorry. Here we go. All his brutal blows could not force from my lips the foul lie that I was a slave. Next quote. My suffering, I can compare to nothing else than the burning agonies of hell. With an exclamation point. So pretty strong statement there. Next quote. A man with a particle of mercy in his soul would not have beaten even a dog so cruelly. So I haven't watched the movie 12 Years a Slave, but the recently made film. But I've kind of heard it referred to as torture porn. And that makes sense because just reading this book, there's many descriptions, many instances of how severely beaten and tortured Solomon Northup, you know, that's the kind of treatment he receives throughout the book. So it makes sense that the movie would be like a torture porn, because that's what the book kind of is. He gets beaten a lot, even in the transition period. He's not a slave yet, technically. He's a slave when he gets sold. But he's not sold yet. Even during the phase where he hasn't been sold, they really try to break his spirit and get him to accept the fact that he's a slave by beating him senselessly over and over and over and over again. I have to wonder, like, how is it that he can take so much of the beating, you know? It's crazy. But that was the reality for him. This was his experience going into slavery. Anyway, I'll continue more in future videos. Definitely more to come. So.